Welcome to the DGL. This is going to be the Season 7 Playoffs Week 1 between VEA, Via Armis, and FgC. That's Fatalis Gaming Clan or Community, I'm not sure which one. This is going to be a best of three tonight between these two teams. VEA played in Division 2 last season, FgC playing in Division 1. VEA, though, competing against Division 1 teams in this playoff tournament because they finished at the top of the Division 2 last season with a 5-0 record. They didn't drop a match. I had the pleasure of playing only about half a game with those guys, but it went very well. FgC, on the other hand, while still playing in Division 1, had a split season. They won 2-3 losses, which put them right about in the middle of their division. So, you know, coming at it from that perspective, I think this is going to be a very close match. We're about to get into the pistol round, and like I said, it's a best of threes. First map is Embassy, obviously, since we're here on it right now. After that, we'll be playing Station, and then if we need to go to a Game 3, which I hope we do, it will be on Ministry. So, since they were in Division 1, this is FGC's map pick. They were a higher seed, and yeah, so we're going to see what they can do with it. VEA is kind of traditionally a little bit weaker on this map, and FGC seemed to know it, this being the map pick. I will say that last night, me and some guys on Boat, former VEA members, had to play on Embassy, and we have been working on it, so we didn't lose that match too bad at all. In fact, we went about as close as it can with us still losing. Lost 9-7 to FDA2. Was a great match. Go back and watch that. Willie and Gems did a great job casting that one. It's good match. Anyways, let's get away from the guys shooting each other in the face. It's very comrade-like behavior. And let's talk about who's going to be playing tonight. On VEA, we've got Bon. Now, he's a sort of powerhouse flanker type. Can also long gun if needs be. Ripjaws is a very, very good positional player. Podroy is an awesome kind of passive support player. Ivilch, of course, is the flank master himself. Ham, look for him to be sniping. And then rushing. He likes to drop the sniper after the first two picks or so. On FGC, we've got Tarpon. He can snipe, he can long gun, he can play passive, he can do whatever you want him to do. He's just an all-around monster of a player. Bad Lightbulb's a new pickup for FGC this time around. He's typically aggressive, I would say, as far as playstyle goes. Look for some interesting things coming from him. He should be a good addition to the team. Snailman, longtime FGC member. I think long gun, sniper, not totally sure. Jorik, excuse me, fucking Joe. I just tend to read out what the players call themselves. It sometimes changes, and I try to honor those changes, but that is Joe. Don't know a whole lot about her playstyle other than very, very solid player. New to FGC mid last season, I believe. And of course, we've got Captain Torix himself, repping DGL.org tags because he is one of our awesome admins over here at the DGL. If you're interested in playing competitive insurgency, go ahead and send yourself over to the TGL.org, get signed up. We do a lot of pugs. There's a TeamSpeak that if you join, you'll get set up with players looking for a match most nights of the week, and especially Fridays. Would encourage anyone who is at all into this game to go and check that out. Just to get formalities out of the way, my name is Torso. Play for a team called Boat. I'm the skipper. And so yeah, if you have, you know, any complaints or anything, please direct them my way. If we're having any issues with the stream, I will be trying to keep an eye on it here and there. Here, keep an eye on chat as well. And so yeah, looks like we're about to go live with the pistol round here. We play a pistol round to decide which side of the map the teams are going to start on for the proper match. FGC electing to start on insurgent side. I believe since they're a higher side, they get to choose the side. It's a higher seed. They get to choose their side for the pistol round. So here they go. We've got the GLAHFs coming out. It's good luck. Have fun in nerd speak. And I'm just going to follow Bad Light here since he's the first out of the gate for FGC. Looks like Ham and Podroy going off by themselves over here. Oh, no, they're splitting up. So we got a pretty standard split coming out of VEA. They spread themselves out around the objectives, and the same happening from FGC. Ham is going to pop tripping with that M9. That's Tarpon, excuse me. Ivilch getting a second kill, and we're already in a 5v3 here in the pistol round. with the Vilch picking up another kill onto Torix. I'm somehow managing to avoid all of the action. We have a little bit of whining coming out of FGC here in the chat. I will go ahead and turn that off in a moment. As soon as this round is done, because I don't want to have to skip any of the action by going into my settings. Got Snailman creeping around just underneath Ripjaws. Now Ripjaws is going to hear Snailman kill Ivilch on Bravo. Wonder if he's going to be able to react to see what Ripjaws is looking at. And it looks like Snailman is going to be able to climb around. Ripjaws with a massive turn onto Snailman just one-taps him in the face. That was a flick and a half, and that is going to win VEA. The pistol round, they're going to stay on security side, and... you know, I'm not entirely sure if this map is security or insurgent-sided. What we have tended to notice in the past is that teams tend to do well on one side or the other. Now, that sounds really dumb coming out of my mouth, but what I mean by that is a team will have... They'll typically win half on the side that they start on, right? And then go on to do poorly on the second side, or vice versa. Right, it's this weird thing where it's not an insurgent or security-sided map, but teams tend to perform extremely well or extremely poorly depending on the side they pick. It just varies per team. I don't know if I'm making any sense there, but it's a pretty even map as far as the meta is concerned. It seems that teams sometimes just have a serious preference for sides. We've got the map restart, and it looks like we're going to get going into the proper match. And they're just wondering if they have to go ahead and keep recording demos or redo that at all. We're recording demos just to see if anything fishy goes on. We can pull demos from players that are suspected of exploiting things or cheating. We're not live, unfortunately. I was hoping we would just be able to get right into the map so I could stop talking about nothing and start talking about gameplay, because my god, it's hard to keep talking by oneself for up to an hour and a half, I believe was the length of the last best of three I cast. Looks like we're going to get live into the match here. Vilch expressing a little bit of frustration. Okay, maybe a lot of frustration. Joe sending out the good luck, have fun, and a heart. And here we go. FGC versus VEA finally getting underway. Looks like we've got Bon heading towards the middle of the map. Looks like he's going to try to get some early Bravo presence. I wonder if he's going to fall to any pre-nades that you sometimes see come out of these things. Sounds like one or two going off, catching him with a little bit of damage, but not doing anything too terrible. Tarpon's going to get a pick across onto him. And looks like after deploying, with the exception of Joe, who's trying to sneak around Alpha here, and Lightbulb being a little bit tentative here in Charlie, they're going to stay put. Ripjaw is going to take out Tarpon, and there goes a very, very strong FGC player early into the round. Looks like we're getting a little bit of a rotation kind of poke by Poteroy over here towards this Windows position. And Ripjaws here sneaking around the spiral stairs. I wonder if he's going to be able to catch out Torix, who's down here, if he's going to be able to see him through these concrete barriers. And by through, I mean through one of the cracks, not through the barrier itself. Ivilch, in the meantime, going to take out Joe on that alpha flank with his MP5, very high rate of fire weapon, that Ivilch somehow still remains... very accurate with. Torix taking a aggressive stance here, checking the wrong way, and Ivilch is going to find himself another kill onto Torix. That's two this round so far. And I say so far because he's capable of so much more from Ivilch. Bond's going to start putting some pressure onto Bravo. And Snailman here is stuck in between Poteroy and Bond. Poteroy hopefully is going to look down and get a pop on him. I'm saying hopefully because, and possibly giving away some of my bias here, I am a former VEA player. So if you hear me saying things like, oh, hopefully VEA is going to win, I do mean it. I'm going to try to be as unbiased as possible, but a little of that may slip out here and there. So VEA is going to take that first round with a 3K for Ivilch. And I'm going to go ahead and pop our handy-dandy overlay up here and give ourselves a round for VEA. It's 1-0 VEA. FGC managing to snatch a couple kills there early in the round, but then not really able to do anything else with it. They tended to kind of get into position there and then stay, maybe to their detriment. Maybe they could try to be a little bit more active on the map. Maybe Joe could push a little bit more onto Alpha if she decides to go that way again. Perhaps their Charlie flank player could try to get a little bit more done there. I believe that was Torix who started over there, but I could be mistaken. Bond's heading towards the middle again. Ham's hanging back again. See if he gets picked by Tarpon. Missing the shot, and in the meantime, Joe is going to go ahead and take down Ivilch. Bond's going to get a response onto Torix, and then Potter is going to pick up Bad Lightbulb. So we're in a 4v3 in favor of VEA right now, with Ham still just looking for this player. Let's sneak across and see who that is. It is Tarpon who got this kill across. Looks like he's going to go for it again. Misses Ham there. I don't know if we were able to see that on stream, because it might have been too quick a peek, and I am running at a very, very high frame rate. But Tarpon could actually see him for a split second across those Bravo windows. Now, that's probably the spot that he made the pick the last time, so I'm not surprised he was looking there again. I am surprised he missed that easy shot. He seems to have a sense that there's a player below him. Maybe he heard him prone just then. I've got my game sound turned down a little bit. And there's Tarpon getting that pick across on Ham again. One thing I will mention about Ham is if he gets killed in the same way more than once, he tends to start to get a little bit tilted. So we could be looking for maybe a little bit more aggravated play style from Ham next round, or if he spawns in this round. In the meantime, Bond's going to get himself a kill. And we've got two VEA players on Bravo. They're double capping this. Bond defending Bravo with a kill onto Snailman, who's trying to poke in. Tarpon's the last up, and he's going to sneak on and just pop Voter in the face. Bond's down too, so here comes Tarpon taking a decisive command over Bravo and making a 3v1 into a 1v1. Ripjaw's here. I wonder if he's going to be able to see Tarpon on that statue position. He is not in Tarpon with just the cool calculated 4K to bring FGC around here. We're 1-1 VEA FGC. I'm going to take a second to check out chat. How's it going, chat? Thank you, Roller, for pointing out how dumb I sound. Kalau, no, I'm totally fine solo streaming.
Give me a sec.
Just had to get the pipes warmed up. It's good to know that everything is looking and sounding okay, though, from the amount of abuse I've got coming at me in the chat. It sounds like you can see and hear everything, so that is awesome. Going hot into round three, Ham has dropped the scope, and this is that more aggravated, kind of aggressive playstyle I said that might come out. Looks like an M4, M16. What do we got here? We got M16, so he's still going to try to play sort of the more one-tap long gun role, playing very passively here on their Bravo stairs. In the meantime, Torix is going to get a pre-frag kill onto Bon, and that is the forward-most VEA player going down. Ivilch is going to respond with a kill onto Joe. And we've actually got Ivilch and Ripjaws very close to each other here, back towards Alpha. Which leaves, as you can see, their other two players just cupped in this four-player cup that FGC has made. But if they get this flank off, which it looks like Ivilch is going to stop up here, if Ripjaws gets this flank off, he could get behind both Tarpon and Snailman and potentially do a lot of damage. Ivilch is going to get a kill on Torix, and I think you just saw Tarpon turn around here. He knows that Ivilch is down there, and he knew that Ripjaws was there. Maybe he caught a sight of him. Maybe he heard him sprinting a second ago. Maybe it's just good game sense to check that corner before he moves on. But he's going to secure that kill. Leaving us in a 3v3 with the team starting to become a little bit intertwined here. We got Ham and Snail about to cross each other on this y-axis. Snail hearing Ham slide. I think Ham is trying to bait, and with the sound there, luckily he's able to just dip, dive, dodge, and this is actually Podoroi, not Ham. Snailman shots and return the favor, getting a shot onto Snailman, getting that kill. Ivilch going to one-tap Tarpon. Bad Lightbulb responds with a kill onto Ham, and then onto Podoroi. We're in a 1v1. We got Ivilch versus Bad Lightbulb. Let's see what the newest addition to FGC can do in a clutch situation for his team. It seems that both players are aware that the other is on this side of the map, and Lightbulb is for sure certain now that Ivilch is on Charlie. He just received an audio notification that we cannot hear that the objective is being capped, and the point just started flashing on the bottom of your screen there. If you see that square C down there, you can start to see a blue line start to creep around the outside, and that means that a security player is capturing a insurgent-held objective. Ivilch is going to get that cap. We got five up for VEA, and we're about to have five up for FGC as well. He knows that this cap is going on, but he's not going to be able to do anything to stop it. Maybe he can get this kill as he jumps off the point. We saw him come up, he's going to pick the head, and we're in a 5v4 in favor of VEA. They also have a map presence advantage with holding both Alpha and Charlie, and as you can see here, just are a lot more spread out. They're going to try to cup these players coming from spawn with Potara getting a kill onto Torix. It's a 5v3. Following Tarpon here, because I'm expecting him to try to make a pick across this map again, but he's not going to be able to find anyone as Potara takes down Snailman. We've got Joe going for the long flank around Alpha, and if they don't stop this decap, we're just going to win. Oh, someone gets on Charlie just in time. Tarpon is just, if you can see this, it's just hardly capped at all in his favor. He seems to know there's a player in the offices, but he's going to get taken down. That's going to be a wipe for FGC. We've got 2-1 in terms of rounds for VEA. Very, very, very good play coming out of both these teams, and I'm just impressed with how locked down Ivilch with the 5k, by the way, that round. How locked down VEA is able to keep this map. Did I hit you through the wall? Potter is saying no. Tarpon saying fuck. I'm pretty sure Tarpon got very close there. I wish I had an instant replay function. I'd like to see that from Potoroy's perspective. If I recall, I think Potoroy maybe legged Tarpon through the wall in response. They're both shooting each other through the wall in offices. All these players, of course, friends with each other. And Tarpon wondering, probably more out of jest and banter purposes if he got that shot through the wall. Ham's going to miss a pick. He saw maybe just a sliver of an enemy player, unless that was Bond coming down the stairs. I'm pretty sure that was an enemy player. I think that's Tarpon across the map again, looking for that shot. And it is Snailman and Joe coming out with 2 kills on Iv and Ripjaws very early on. We're at 5v3, and Bond's kind of stuck out here. He doesn't have a whole lot of cover anymore. Ham's going towards Alpha, and Potara is in, well, no situation to cover Bond. And he's right below Snailman. I'm just going to try to get in the free cam here really fast, see if we can see this. Snailman going to refrag Bon after he gets a kill onto Torix. Bad Lightbulb going to pick up Potoroy. Ham with a pistol kill onto Joe, and Tarpon's going to capture Bravo. So now we're in a 1v5. Ham is the last man up, and that's a nasty little flick coming out of Snailman. He's going to just drag that iron sight across Ham's face and take him down. We're at 2-2, all tied up here. VEA FGC on Embassy tonight. So far, very, very even match. This is more or less what I was expecting out of these two teams. Even though they were knocked into D2 last season, and I might add, the reason they went down to D2, I'm talking about VEA, was a kind of fucky placement match on this map. They played against FTA or FTA2, I'm not sure which squad it was. There are so many FTA squads, I can't keep them straight. They had a massive comeback. It was something like 7-1, and they ended up, FTA managed to come back and take it to overtime, and then win in overtime. It was pretty heartbreaking to watch that as a VEA player at the time, and as a VEA fan all the time. Let's see if the VEA Embassy curse continues, or if they just continue holding their own against FGC here. We do have a couple of VEA players going down very quickly. Ivilch responding with a kill onto Joe. Snailman's going to pick up a kill onto Ripjaws. Now we've got Bond just, again, waiting towards the middle of the map. He should probably make a move to try to stop this cap onto Bravo, because they're just going to bring Joe back in. It's 5v3. I know it's not maybe as big a difference if it's four players up rather than five, but, you know, it's a positional advantage thing. You've got this player coming in from their side of the map, which could have done something to a flank if it had been happening from VEA. Ivilch is going to make it 2v4, and now it's just a 1v4. Got Ivilch here running around, just trying to put some distance between him and his last known position. But Tarpon knows what's up. He heard him pre-fire Ivilch as he comes back around that stairwell, and it's going to be 3-2 in favor of FGC. Just very, very impressive game awareness, as always, coming out of Tarpon. And just taking a look at the frags really quickly here, we've got Tarpon top fragging for his team, more or less as expected. He's 8-3. Ivilch, 10-3 over here on the VEA side. A little bit more of an impressive scoreline, especially when we consider he's got another cap on top of Tarpon. The rest of the team, pretty even spread of kills. Looks more or less the same on each side. We got some fives, we got some, you know, maybe not so hot scores. We got Ripjaws and Ham who are waiting to step up. We got Torix, who's probably doing more captaining right now than he is fragging, which is fine. That's sometimes the role of the captain, is not to be the most high impact player, but rather to direct your high impact players so that they're more effective. It seems to be what he is doing. Probably calling for these greens to come out because they were so successful against Bond last time. We got Ham, it sounds like he missed a shot. Snailman going to take out Ham. Lightbulb going to take out Ivilch. And we've got Vaughn just playing very passively back here this time. He's not going to run out onto Bravo and die to a pre-nade anytime soon. We do have Lightbulb picking up another kill. He's going to kill Podoroy. Torix is 75% on this objective, which they don't need. They have all their players up. He'd be wise to leave this at 90. He's not going to get off in time. They're going to cap that point. That's a respawn wasted that they potentially could have used later if VEA starts to turn this round around. Bond potentially looking to face a couple players here. He knows they're there. That's what that spray is. Of course, that's not going to do much other than maybe hold up Bad Light at these stairs for a couple extra seconds. He's going to take a couple shots here across at something that I didn't see. I don't know if he saw it either. I think he's just guessing. Ripjaws is going to get a kill onto Joe, though, and that makes it a 2v4, but Bond's about to get swarmed. He hears Lightbulb jumping around. I'm not sure if that was a sound bait or if he's jumping down some stairs or something. But his patience is going to pay off, and there goes Bad Light. Of course, Torix is going to come in with the rotation here. He could touch Alpha, but that would alert immediately Bond to his presence. But Bond already knows he's trying to pick the head over this little barrier, come around, and barrel stuff him. We're in a 2v2. VEA is managing to bring this back just with some very, very clever play, and I wonder if Ripjaws is going to be able to get that flick. He is unfortunately not. Tarpon was just waiting for someone to get onto Bravo there. Snailman's going to clear it so they know if they try this again. And here is Bond. I think Snailman just saw the top of his head. Almost TKs Tarpon. That would have been exactly what Bond needed here. At the very least, it's caused a little bit of confusion, caused Tarpon to hit the dirt. I think Bond knows where both these players are. If his count is good, he knows there's two up. VEA is pretty good at keeping a count. But since they're watching roughly where Bond is, they've kind of got him covered no matter which way he wants to come at this, unless he completely, reorients himself. It looks like also Tarpon is kind of get in a position where he can see where Bond is now. You can start to see him peeking on your screen here. Bond's with the good eyes. Gonna see him and manage to live through that spray. Tarpon whiffing just a little bit. He had Bond all but dead to rights there. And in the meantime, Bond's gonna get up on top of Bravo and pop Snailman, who was just prone inside there watching it. It's a 1v1. We got Bond on Tarpon right now. And, just a very, very surprising comeback round here for VEA. It looked like FGC had this all wrapped up, and Tarpon's actually gonna go trade. This is a good move, because if we hit zero time, like we will in about 20 seconds here, FGC will have two objectives, two VEAs, one. So what Bond's going to have to do, he's going to cap this in time to cap his team back in. He's got 10 seconds to get to Bravo. If he doesn't get on Bravo, they've lost the round. If he gets on Bravo, which he just has, you can kind of hear Tarpon kicking himself now in your head. Although he is going to pick up a kill. I think he just clicked. I think he's out of ammo, and if Ivilch heard that, which he unfortunately did not seem to hear, Tarpon running out of ammo, he would have just pushed him and killed him. Wouldn't have been anything Tarpon could have done about that. Slew of kills coming out for VEA. Bad Light's going to pick one up. Tarpon's going to pick up Ivilch. We're in a 3v2 favoring VEA right now. Looks like the caps, however, are going to favor FGC, unless Ripjaws can stop the gap here. He sees the player, whiffs the spray. You can shoot through just about everything on this point, though. I don't know what he's waiting for. He's going to start capping Alpha. Ripjaws and Bond in a clutch situation again together. Bond going to flick, pick up a kill on Bad Lightbulb. It's a 2v3. They just have to hold on and guard this Alpha cap. If they can get this Alpha cap before FGC can get to Alpha or Bravo, they will have the round. And Bond's just going to camp out on Bravo, knowing that's exactly where they're heading. He's going to block the cap out coming from Torix, who also has Snailman flanking around. That was a very, very good flank. Playing two players on Bravo is exactly what FGC had needed to do. And now VEA is in a very tough spot. We have Ripjaws, who's probably the most forward player. He needs to get on to Bravo. He needs to stop the cap. He sees both of them. Unfortunately, he doesn't stop to take the shot. He had them both dead to rights there. This round is going to go in favor of FGC. They're just going to win on caps, but that was a very, very back-and-forth round. Hotly contested. Down to the wire. We were in zero time for a good couple minutes, it seemed, there. A lot of kills coming out of both the teams, and you can see that reflected on the scoreboard, how we had a jump from the previous round. We got Tarpon sitting at 12 kills, and we got Bond and Ivilch. We got 11 on Bond, we got 10 on Ivilch. Looks like Ivilch just picked up one kill that round, but Bond Man, almost clutching it twice in a row there in the same round. That is insane. Him and Riptiles really did some work to keep VEA in that round as long as they could hang out. So we're sitting at 2-4 in favor of FGC. Let's see if VEA is going to do anything to switch this up. Ham is rocking the M16 again, or possibly an M4. It's difficult to tell from the first-person player model. That is an M4. Possibly playing a little bit more forward, but he's going to go for this pick across, which is dangerous. He's been losing that to Tarpin more than half of the time. And there it is. Tarpin just manages to sneak a headshot in there. Ivilch, though, takes out Joe. Torix is going to get a kill onto Ivilch after that to get a refrag there. And now we come to the part of the match, the part of the round where everyone's just kind of chilling out, except for, it seems, Bad Lightbulb and Torix actually running around. I was expecting some very passive play at this point. Bad Light missing the first spray, managing to secure the kill on a Podoroy. Nonetheless, we've got Bond taking down Torix and Tarpin getting another kill. He's going to kill Ripjaws. We're on a 1v3. Bond in a clutch situation again, and there's really only so many clutches you can have per match, guys. You got to stop putting Bond in this situation. Not any detriment to his skill. He's obviously a very skilled player, as we've seen so far this match, but this is just a lot of stress piling up onto one player. Good eyes on Bond, seeing the head of that FGC player, but Bad Lightbulb is going to win out in the end as Bond starts to turn around and put some distance between himself and that player. That's going to be another round for FGC. It's 5-2. I'm going to check in with the Twitch chat here, see if we get any more abuse. Let's see here. Wow, that casting. Thank you. In 20 seconds, we'll be at zero time. Hey, Roller, you know, some people don't know how to play the game. You would know. Let's see here. We got... why is he so nervous? He's just casting. I am trying to fill as much space as possible. I also haven't eaten very much today. I think I'm suffering from low blood sugar. So if I start to say things to prove my words, please excuse me. Let's see here. I'm also just very excited to see these two teams play. And I hope you can hear that in my voice, just the excitement, the tension, the mad rush of adrenaline that is competitive insurgency here at the DGL. Got Ivilch working on a little bit of a flank here, and if he's lucky, he'll be able to get a flank on Joe. Joe, I think, heard him take that jump, or maybe she's just watching this position out of habit. But if Ivilch peeks this incorrectly, he's going to die, and there he goes. Let's go over here to Torix, who's hanging out in the spiral stairs, sneak up on a player. Bad Light, in the meantime, going to get on a kill on Ripjaws. Torix facing the wrong direction. He's over there. Bond's going to pick up the kill. Bad Light Bulb showing up huge. He's going to get another two kills as Joe takes down Bond to win the half for her team. It's 6-2 at half, and I think Ham has had enough. Or possibly just had some internet trouble. So yeah, very dominant half in the end coming out for FGC. A lot of those rounds back and forth, but, I mean, you really can't deny the 6-2 scoreline as being a dominant scoreline. You've won three times as many rounds as your opponent, despite how close those rounds have been. That a gigantic advantage. This is FGC's map pick, however, so this is more or less what you would expect, or what you, and it's definitely what you would hope for, being FGC. VEA, though, have seen comebacks on this map before. They've been on the wrong end of them, but they know it's possible. I think what they're going to try to do here is just rally, treat this side like a whole new game, and just draw from sort of past successes that they've been having. And I just like to point out Bond up here, Ivilch up here, and the kills. Those two players are doing great things for their team. We got Podoroy also showing up here, just barely negative in the KD. But you can compare that to some players over on the FGC side who have nonetheless had some very high impact kills, who have been doing some very good things with objectives. I'm talking about Torix and Joe. Sitting a little prettier with the kills over here on Podoroy, you know? So he's maybe getting a little bit more actual killing done, but a little bit less important kills they have been. Tarpin and Bad Light, top fragging the server, though. Really can't argue with those KDs, 14-4, 13-5. They're just both having very good games so far, you know? I'd like to point out the objective caps for both these teams. We got 8 for FGC, and I don't know if Ham had any. I'm going to assume no, because it's been hanging back, mostly getting shot by Tarpin. So we got a total of 4 over here, despite that crazy zero-time round we had a few rounds ago. Only 4 caps coming out for VEA. Looks like we're going to try to find a sub for him. Ivilch making a little bit of a joke. I'm assuming it's just internet problems. Players, no matter how frustrated they get in these matches, they typically don't just disconnect. They typically don't rage quit, especially when they know they're being watched by the entire community. Here comes Ham, as expected. Sounds like just an internet hiccup. I remember yesterday during the boat match, we were having troubles with the server. This is a different server. We're here on Chai 3 today. Lovely, sunny, but somehow kind of rainy. Wait, what is going on with the weather on this map? Hold on a fucking second. Hold on a fucking second. It's quite obviously raining here. And clear as day over here. NWI, please. Anyways, if you are a VEA fan, let's hear it in chat. Let's get some of the rallies. Let's get some of the cheers. Let's get some of the, those somewhat inappropriate soccer songs or something. Just really anything we'll do. Just post it in chat. Let's get some support for VEA. They're down 4 rounds at 6-2 here. We're just about to start the second half with VEA here on Insurgent side. And it looks like we're going to have Poderoy and Ham going Charlie. Ripjaws heading up the middle. I'm assuming he's going to head towards Bravo. Ivilch going for a flank, of course. And we actually have Bond getting onto Bravo. He's just going to tap it and bait it. And immediately get off of it. We've got Snailman over here looking for that player. Maybe he senses it was a bait. Ripjaws opening us up with a kill onto Tarpon. There goes FGC's ace immediately. Bond getting a kill on Snailman. We're in a 5v3 with FGC honestly looking a little bit lost. We got Torix just starting to cap that objective. He gets flashed momentarily, so we do have a reaction coming out of VA, a very strong one. Mon's going to get on. He's going to discover that it was a bait. Ivilch, in the meantime, going to take out Jorix. Badlight taking out Poderoy. And Ham's going to take out Torix. So now it's all down to Badlight, who's going to be able to pick up a kill onto Ham on that Charlie ramp location. And you can see that we've got some strategy discussions happening here in the sidebar. We cannot hear that. I turned my voice volume all the way down. We got Badlight staying alive. That was an interesting killer onto that last player who seemed to turn away after the first volley. Maybe he was a little bit overconfident in the hit reg. In this game, sometimes it helps just to be sure to put one or two extra rounds into the player. It is also entirely possible that he whiffed the shot. I was not watching from his perspective, so there's no way to know for sure. I'll have to, ask him about it. Probably going to be one talked about. That was a very embarrassing way to go. Badlight is blocked on this point. He's going to step off? Yeah, he's going to step off. Maybe hoping to bait out a player, and he does. Ivilch backing his booty out of the offices, getting shot in the ass. And that's going to be a cap for Badlight. He's bringing his whole team back in. We got 5 FGC players coming right at Bon, who it looks like he's going to be able to get this cap, unless Badlight has something to say about it. It looks pretty safe. He's going to cap. Bravo. Badlight immediately killing him, though, getting the exit frag. We got 4 players coming from spawn, and Badlight heading straight for them. Ivilch with a good awareness, knowing the spawn camp would be possible, going to kill Badlight, and now we're in a 4v4. Snailman's going to throw a pre-nade, which is going to do nothing. It's going to land somewhere over here in this big gap where all these players are not hanging out right now. Large Charlie presence for VEA right now. We got Ham and Ripjaws over here. We had Poderoy over there a second ago, but it looks like he's going to try to rotate. There go 2 quick kills. Torix and Game Analyzer Jorix getting a couple. Ripjaws managing to take down Torix. He's going to start that Charlie cap. Bravo's already 75% capped here. Snailman's just lying down. I think he knew that player was there. Poderoy getting out of there with his life, but just barely. We still have Ripjaws capping Charlie, but in the meantime, Snailman and Tarpon are going to quick cap. You cap faster when there's more than one player on a point. Bravo bring their team back in. And I'm just sort of waiting for Poderoy to die at this point. Managing to pick up a kill on this Snailman, who was facing the wrong way, but Joe, with the awareness knowing her teammate was getting shot at, wasn't that hard to figure out since they were right next to each other. Picking up the kill on Poderoy, and coming out of spawn, we got 3 players from VEA. That's a nasty spawn camp from Joe. Going to take down Ivilch, and she's just going to stay there. She could profit from this again. It's going to do enough. It's going to keep Ham penned in the spawn. We're going to hit the time limit. And since FGC had control over more points than VEA, they're going to take the round 7-2 in favor of FGC.
Watch my back, I need to... I gotta reload!
Bodoroy is saying live, just reminding us that we are indeed playing a match here. Or maybe someone had a drop momentarily. Not really sure what was going on there, I must have missed it. I was tabbed out, making sure no one was posting anything horrible in chat. I'm watching you, Foxtra. See, again, if anything is going to come out differently for VEA here. It looks like they're just keeping up with the standard bait, Bravo, pressure. Oh, he's actually sticking the cap here on Bravo. He's going to stay on there for a little while, see if he can get that capped most of the way. We've got Torix. Bond's going to hear him. Ripjaws and Bond working together to take out Torix there. I think you heard him running past Bravo, and Badlight's going to start to make moves towards this Charlie objective because he needs to start capping his team back in. He's in a 2v5 right now. FGC not finding any traction this round so far. And, well, there goes Badlight. There goes their Charlie, man. And Tarpon, I think you heard a player running, or maybe that was an attempt at a refrag. Taking a shot off towards that window position. He's going to get capped out unless he gets on Bravo right now. But unfortunately for him... Oh, no, fortunately for him, no one's watching it right now. He chose exactly the right moment to get in there. That was just swarming with VEA a second ago, and he's already 25% capped in here. They know where he is. They really do just need to run at him and kill him, which they're going to do. Ivilch securing that kill onto Tarpon. That's 7-3. Another round for VEA on the board. Could this be the start? Could this be the comeback that they're looking for? Channeling those FTA comeback vibes. I'm hoping to see at least a few more rounds here. VEA finding some momentum, finding their stride. Pick up a few more rounds to make this a little bit more of a contest here on this first map. This is FGC's map pick, and if it doesn't, even if they win it, even if FGC wins it, if it doesn't go as smoothly as possible, right, with a 9-3 at this point, they're going to start thinking to themselves, like, okay, what did we do wrong? We lost rounds on our map pick. We know VEA is weak on this map. They've been weak on it in the past. Tarpon obviously knows where the picks are. Joe knows where to spawn camp. You know, Badlight knows how to run around this map. They have practiced this map. If they don't do incredibly well on this, I think it will carry over into the next map, which will be Station, which is VEA's pick. VEA very strong on Station, and possibly do some mental damage to FGC if this map does not go like 100% in their favor. You know what I mean? So we've got Bon and Ripjaws taking out Snailman. We got Badlight taking out Ham, and that leaves us in a 2v3. With three VEA players up, Podoroy going to block this cap on Charlie. And Lightbulb just playing passively. Joe sneaking around. There's no one around her. She's near the point that they hold already. I'm not entirely sure what she's trying to do here. Maybe she's going to try to go for spawns after Ripjaws captures Bravo. Badlight going to take out Podoroy. But we still have Vaughn on Charlie, so he's still blocked. Let's see what he does about this. We also have Ham coming in for the flank. Badlight hears him. Ham checking all of the angles. Badlight and Ham knowing each other where each other are. Maybe Ham sees a barrel there. I think he does, and he gets him through the wall, it looks like, with that M1 carbine. We're down to a 1v3 featuring Joe on FGC, Bon, Ivilch, and Ham on VEA. And she's going to cap Alpha back in her favor just a little bit, then hop off of it. Unfortunately for her, Ivilch is waiting right there for her. I think maybe they assumed that there was a player Alpha side because they had not seen her yet in the round. They were thinking to themselves, okay, where have we gotten kills? We've gotten kills here, 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 and here. Where have we not gotten a kill? Where have we not seen a player? Where have they not pushed from? You know, where would they have split off in the beginning of the map and then, you know, gotten stuck in Joe's case, not done anything? Where could they still be lurking? Figured that out. Waited over there for the rotation. And killed her. So that's another round for VEA. They're still in this, guys. It's 7-4. It's not looking, you know, great still, but they at least have another round that they could potentially lose and still be in the game as a buffer. And they're not playing for a tie yet. They could potentially still be playing for the win here. If they take the next 5 rounds in a row, they will win this first map against practically all odds. I mean, this is just not their map. And Tarpon, again, getting the pick across. He doesn't know he got it. He doesn't know how good a shot he is because he keeps shooting in that one location. But that is just a nasty way to open up this round with him going down in the first maybe 10 or 15 seconds. That's just pretty much devastating morale-wise for VEA. A lot of players playing around, but not on Bravo. I'm sorry, Torix actually is on Bravo. Maybe VEA thinks this is a bait. Bond's going to hop on. Start the block. Here's Torix running, taking him out. In the meantime, Bad Light is going to take out Ripjaws, and we are in a 3v3. This is a very even match. Tarpon and Bad Light right on top of each other. And we got Joe heading towards Bravo. It looks like all three players are going to head towards Bravo. It's a straight press onto Bravo. Bond here on his lonesome, going to get taken out just by sheer numbers. Got Ivil sneaking around towards Alpha. He's going to clear the point before hopping on, starting to cap. Podoroy playing defensively on Charlie, not being much use to his team at the moment. All the action is happening on Bravo. I think he's realizing that, and that's what's prompting this rotation. They know they need to stop this Bravo cap, or else they're going to be in a very dire 2v5. Taking a guess at a pre-fire. Unfortunately, he's not going to be too lucky, and he is going to discover that there is no one on that point anymore. Tarpon, a couple quick kills just to tie up the round. He gets a 3K. And now VEA is playing for a tie. I will admit that much. 8-4 in favor of FGC. This could be the last round coming up here. VEA needs your support now as much as ever. I see the rip boat thing coming out. Captivate, that's not very nice. We still have next week to play. We're still in the tournament, buddy. So, let's get some support coming out for VEA right now, though. We'll talk about boat later. If we have a break or something, I will go ahead and do some shameless promotion. But VEA needs your support. Let's go VEA, rah, rah, rah. Let's keep themselves alive in this match. Take it to overtime. Let's see if Tarpon gets this mad pick across this time. They're going to deny him by not standing in the same window three or four times in a row. That's a good call from VEA. We got Ivilch pushed up very far, and he's just going to get flanked by Torix. That was nasty. He had Torix and Joe right next to him. He was a dead man pushing into that situation. Podor is going to take out Bad Light Bulb, but Snailman is going to kill Bon. We're in a 4v3 favoring FGC. Make that a 4v2 with Podor going down to Tarpon. Now we've got Ham on the Bravo stairs. Unfortunately, not going to be able to connect. Torix taking him out. And we got Ripjaws, last man alive here on Bravo. Looks like it's going to go in favor of FGC. That was a very, very good first map. We got Ripjaws maybe DCing. I'm assuming these players know it's a best of three. We do have at least one more map coming up here at the TGL. And I'm just going to take a quick second to run and grab some water here in between maps. Because I think I've got a moment here. I'm not sure what's going on with these players leaving the game. Maybe I will turn on my... Oh, they're joining back in. Okay, good. At any rate, I'm going to shut up for a good at least 10 or 15 seconds while I go grab some water, because, man, my throat is fucking parched. Stay tuned for map number 2. It's going to be Station. That's VEA's map pick here on the DGL. Be right back, guys. Alright, we are loaded into our second map of the night. Looks like we still haven't started the pistol round. I would be horrified if we had already, what with everyone just running around with their heads cut off. Turning a careful eye to chat, I'd like to say hello to Slim, hello to Kayla, hello to Roller, shout out to Captivate, hey Bizzle, hey Nerd, hey Ganota, hey Murdoch, hello everyone here at the DGL. We've got another match coming at you, and let's just talk about Station for a second. Let me get into a free cam here. Now, before yesterday, I would have said Insurgent side was my preferred side. And that's because of the pre-nade advantage. You can toss a lot of really fun pre-nades onto Ridge. Some of them land outside the Hell Door here. Some of them bounce around over here and kill players going to the Alpha Door. I would have said that's my favorite side. But playing passively on security side is extremely powerful on this map. If you can wait out the pre-nades and early aggression from Insurgents, you can have them run into your guns on security side. So be looking for these teams to do that. Play aggressive on Insurgent side, use the pre-nade possibility, and then just hopefully sit security side and let people make mistakes into their crosshairs. We got FGC with a couple of quick kills here. Bad Light and Joe. Bad Light again. And it's a 5v2. Bon and Ripjaws up for VEA. Bon looking away at exactly the wrong time. There's a player in 10. Don't know if he knows he's there. Bon just heard him run, though. Bad Light and Ripjaws both getting a couple kills. Ripjaws staying alive in this 1v3, but he is completely called out. He is seen. Joe's in a really good position. They've basically locked him down. It looks like Tarpon's going to go around for the flank, and he's going to pre-fire the shit out of him, is my prediction. I think Tarpon's going to just run in and pre-fire him. Or maybe he thinks he's not there anymore. Well, Ripjaws is going to take an ill-advised peek and go down to Tarpon. So that's the pistol round in favor of FGC. Let's see which side they decide to start on. My guess would be the side that they did the pistol on. So I think they're going to stay, because I'm pretty sure that if you're a higher seed, you get to pick which side you start the pistol on. Maybe they're alternating being nice. Maybe if VEA picked this time. I'm not sure. We're about to see, and yes, indeed, FGC is staying on the Insurgent side. So like I said earlier, we should be looking for pre-nades to come out from essentially Insurgent spawn. It's a little, hill here behind this building called Candles. Typically throw some grenades onto... why did my camera go over here? Onto Ridge, maybe some back here on the river trying to get players crossing to Charlie. Maybe even some. There's a really fun one you can throw onto these barrels and just dunk players if they get on here too early. If you just hang back Insurgent spawn and you hear them capping and you know that they've been going to this position, you can toss a pre-nade that explodes right in their face. It's a very, very fun, very effective nade you can throw from back here. Other things to watch out for would be Ham sniping from Insurgent side. I don't think he'd like to pick from security side, but this is a good position to pick a cross pick for snipers from security side. From Insurgent side, look for someone to be hanging out back here. I'm assuming Tarpon or Snailman. Let's just double check here, see what everyone's running here. Snailman is going to be running a AKM, so it won't be him picking AKM for Tarpon. So maybe no sniping this time around for FGC, and let's just see what these pre-nades do, because I see a lot of grenades in hands, and I see VEA maybe not waiting them out as much as they should. Indeed, F1 frag from Snailman getting a kill onto Ripjaws, who's maybe just a little bit too ambitious trying to get to Alpha before he should have. Tarpon getting a kill onto Ivilch, but not before Ivilch can take out Joe. Tarpon getting another kill onto Bond just outside of 10. And that leaves Poderoy and Ham. Ham getting a kill inside Alpha. Poderoy playing here in the strategic position, but he might go down to this player in 10. Bad Light legging the player. That's got to be frustrating when you are able to hit a player, but the hit does not deal enough damage to kill them. That was good reaction time. Poderoy was actually in the air when he took that shot, so good shot at a Bad Light. Unfortunately, it's not going to be enough, and Poderoy is going to get this cap going here on Bravo. He's over half capped, and we've got Snailman running in here. Poderoy looks away at the wrong time. Tarpon and Snailman getting back-to-back kills very quickly that end the round in FGC's favor. I'm just going to reset our scoreboard. Excuse me for not doing that beforehand. But we're 1-0 here in favor of FGC. Hopefully VEA waits out the pre-nades this time. There was one really nasty one just outside the Alpha Door that took down Ripjaws early that last round. If Snailman throws that again, and he should, if their count was good, they realize that they finished up that match with one kill kind of in the remainder. If they're counting the kills they got from guns, they should realize that they got one pre-nade kill. Hopefully they throw those same pre-nades again. Here comes one just over my head. That would have got anyone crossing to Charlie. Luckily, FGC is going to miss all those pre-nades because VEA waited. Ham and Ivilch, well, going ham. There goes the village again. That's four very quick kills, and we're stuck with Tarpon here in the shrine position. You can see everybody is looking at him. He's either been called out, or they've just assumed that this is where he is because they've killed everyone else everywhere else. Tarpon's a little stuck here. VEA is going to cap Ham back in, more than likely, and they're just going to keep him contained here. Tarpon knows roughly where they're shooting him from when they shoot. He's going to try to defenestrate here. That means to jump out of the window. Unfortunately, Ivilch is going to kill Tarpon, and now we're up to a 1-1. VEA picking up around. Let's see here. We got an objective cap for Poderoy, and that's it for objectives in the game so far. I know it's just the third round, but it just kind of shows you how quickly rounds tend to go here on station. It's a very small map, and of course you can, you know, as evidenced by all of the prenades you see and just how easy it is to throw them. I learned the other day that there is a reason for that. There's no skybox in this map, or it's very, very high because it's a community-made map. That's why you're able to throw prenades with such abandon here. Here come a couple more. Trying to get that Charlie Cross player. He's actually going to get legged, but Poderoy getting a frag from security side onto Joe. Badlight responding with a kill onto Ham. Tarpon picking up a kill onto Ivilch. And I'm just trying to find the action as it happens, but there's just so much. Tarpon's going to get another kill onto Bond. There's a prenade exploding in the air. And Poderoy and Ripjaws are right next to each other. Not a lot of map control coming out of them, but a lot coming out of FGC. We've got control of Charlie's side from Tarpon. Snailman locking down Terrace. We've got Torix inside Alpha, and Badlight also on this sandbags position. And I think Poderoy and Ripjaws right now are probably just talking to each other, trying to figure out what they should do, where should they go. They know someone's capping Alpha. If he peeks this, though, Ripjaws is going to die. Torix holding this angle. Ripjaws with a really nice pick on a Torix. I think he had a lucky guess. Torix was there. Badlight Bulb going to kill Poderoy outside of Alpha, though. And Ripjaws has someone coming out his backside. Bad Light Bulb going to get the flank. Last two kills in the round to deliver that round for FGC. That's 2-1 FGC. And these have been fast and brutal rounds. I would like to say that they've been closer, but they've been pretty decisive for whichever team has ended up winning them, with a lot of kills coming at the beginning of the round for either side. So yeah, not a whole lot of back and forth that happens on station usually, unless it turns into a drawn out 1v1 due to just some prenades or some other thing. Here comes a nade towards Charlie's side. That's going to do nothing. There's no one over there. Snailman, however, is going to get a cross pick onto Ivilch. Ham with a kill onto Torix. Bond taking out Bad Light Bulb. This really opens up Alpha. Snailman is back here, so if VEA pushes all the way through, they will have to deal with him, but until then, they can just control this entire half of the map, and you see that happening here. With Bond getting another kill, further clearing out the side of the map, they're just pushing FGC's control back towards this Charlie kind of corner of the map that Tarpon is on. And Snailman here, he's going to start moving and making noise at exactly the wrong time. I think Ham heard him. He did. He's going to take line that shot up and take him out. We're down to Tarpon, who is once again in a 1v in that shrine position. I thought that was going to be a free kill for Tarpon, but Ripjaws turns on him. Very good turn out of Ripjaws. This is the second one we've seen tonight, the first one being on Embassy. Just really good flick and mechanics out of Ripjaws. He's going to help his team get another round. We're tied up 2-2 VEA. FGC here. 5 kills coming out of him. He's currently leading his kill, his team in kills. And we got Tarpon with 6. We got Joe and Torix both dropping donuts here, unfortunately, here in the 5th round. They've had ample opportunities to get kills. They haven't been getting prenated too badly. I think maybe Poderoy got one from this side, so I'm not really sure why they're not able to have more of an impact. Both those players are more than capable of getting kills here. Ivilch getting an MP5K. Kill onto Bad Lightbulb, and he's going to continue just rolling on through this Alpha point, going up to Heaven, killing Torix. We've got Bond taking some shots at, I believe that's still Tarpon up there in the shrine position, who's going to respond by panning him through tin. He couldn't even see that player, he just knew roughly his position and shot through the very thin tin walls. With armor-piercing rounds, that tin's not going to do too much to the damage potential of these FMJs. We got Ripjaws taking out Joe. A lot of fire coming out. I believe that's Tarpon shooting from this stealth position. He's getting shot back at. I think that might be Ham or Poderoy returning fire. Poderoy very, very patient player here on Bravo, waiting for Snailman to drop, gets a kill. Ham's going to finally take out Tarpon, and that's another round into VEA's pocket, pulling out an advantage. 3v2. Set up a momentary mute key for moments like that. Just shows you the level of professionalism we aspire to here at the DGL.org. Excuse me. Got some pre-nades coming out, but I'm not... I don't think they're going to do too much, so I'm not going to follow them as intently anymore. Instead, I'm going to watch Bonds push up here onto Ridge. And Ham and Ivilch are winning Alpha every time for their team, and I think that... might be what is delivering these rounds for these players. Tarpon, though, with a good pick, I believe, again, from that shrine position. We've got Ivilch sneaking up on him. Onto Bon. Ivilch is going to get up here to shrine and wonder what's going on. Tarpon dropped. I wonder if Ivilch has the savvy to know that he is down there. He does. He takes him out. Podoroy, in the meantime, getting the better of Snailman. We're down to Torix in a 1v4, and this is a very tight spot. He's got a player above him who knows where he is. He hears him. He's going to get dropped on. That was an absolutely disgusting kill from Ham. I hate to be on the receiving end of those kind of plays. That's going to be, I believe, 4-2-2 in favor of VEA. Just very aggressive alpha play coming out of VEA. They're not doing too much anywhere else on the map, and that's a good thing. They're not pushing into any situations that they know they cannot win. They realize that Tarpon has things locked down pretty well up there from Shrine, and hopefully Bond's more aware of that position from this point on, not getting killed on Ridge with those pushes. In fact, I'm going to follow Tarpon this time. I didn't think he was going to pop a pre-nade there. I thought he'd maybe just try to get across quicker and safer, see if he could optimize his killing potential from this top shrine position. He's going to make it across, and we do have a cross-pick attempt coming out. He's not even going to go up to shrine this time, though. I think he heard the player prone, but it's too late. Ripjaws takes him out before he can capitalize on Ivilch going prone there. There is another player near that shrine position. It is Joe. Ivilch is going around to the flank, but Joe, a little bit too smart for that. She's going to take out Ivilch. Meanwhile, Podoroy is getting killed on Bravo. Ham getting a response kill onto Torix. We've got Badlight and Bond in a dance of death here around these hell stairs. Badlight is completely surrounded, but he manages to take down one of the three players who is surrounding him. Gets on the back of Bon, and Bon is down as well. And there goes Badlight to Ham. We got Joe and Snail on Ham. Ham's in a 1v2. He's going to toss, looks like, a flashbang out there to try to flash those two players. Looks like it flashes Joe, which is enough to get him safely onto Bravo, where he will die very quickly to Snailman. However, he would have been dead long before then if Joe had not been flashed. That was a very good attempt. That is 4-3 in favor of FGC. And I heard some kind of ding notification a second ago. I'm not sure what that was. If that was the stream hiccuping, I am sorry. It sounded like a TeamSpeak thing, but I am currently muted, AFK, do not disturb, etc. in TeamSpeak, so who the fuck really knows? In fact, you know, let's just close that fucking program. I think the fewer processes, the better. There we go. Let's get back into the game here. We've got Snailman getting a kill onto Ivilch early on. That puts 5-4 in favor of VEA. Ham evening it up with a kill onto Joe. Looks like Bond did some early damage to her as well. Snailman watching this ridge position just to catch players coming over the top of it. Meanwhile, Ripjaws is going to get a kill onto Tarpon. There's a bunch of players around Alpha for VEA, two of them. With Bond here on the ridge, so I guess that's pretty close to Alpha. We got Badlight, though, waiting up in heaven. He's just lurking. He's just waiting for someone to push down there. He wants someone to get overzealous. He wants someone to get too aggressive. He wants someone to push into his position. Maybe he's getting a little bit feisty himself. Unfortunately, Podoroy, a little more patient. Gonna get that kill, and now Ripjaws is gonna pick up Snailman to end the round in VEA's favor. And we're just kind of trading rounds at this point. It's going back and forth. Let's take a look here at the scoreboard at half. Now that was VEA winning half by 2 points, two rounds. So at half we have, unfortunately, Torix still dropping a bit of a zero here. That's really too bad. He needs to show up and support his team. Joe is just starting Reloading to wake magazines. Up. If she can get in this game, then maybe they can turn this around here in the second half. A little bit of a change of scenery as well. Couldn't hurt. Tarpon leading kills with 8. It doesn't seem like he's gotten too much done in the last couple of rounds. Podoroy, 4. But 2 objectives. Podoroy's been playing back. He's been playing a support role. He's been making calls. He's been that guy who lags behind and kills flankers. He gets caps. He's really doing his job very well. Ham has been destroying people on Alpha. Let's see what he decides to do from this side. Usually he snipes from Insurgent side, at least the first couple of rounds. Ivilch and Ripjaws, both doing well. Bon, maybe taking over kind of the team captain role for this game due to the lack of Armageddon, who would normally be making the calls here for this VEA squad. Ham missing the snipe, but Podoroy getting a pre-nade kill onto Torix. Tarpon responding with M16 pick onto Ivilch, and there is a very nice pick out of Ham onto Snailman. He got him when he was sliding. That's a very hard animation to hit players in. Anyone who plays this game knows what I'm talking about. At the moment, though, we do have Joe getting a cap on Bravo. She's about a little over halfway capped. In the meantime, she's going to get a kill onto Podoroy as well. She's defending her own cap. It's a very great play. Ham's going to say no ma'am to that, though. Shuts her down on that cap. It's about 75%, and one of these FGC players needs to get on that point. We got Bon searching around for the player that might have gone to Alpha. He's going to tap it, and that's going to make Bad Lightbulb come back here. If you heard him prone, he's a dead man. Unfortunately, he did not. Bon getting the snake in the grass kill, shooting him in the ankles. Tarpon getting a kill onto Ripjaws as he tries to rotate around. And these teams are all just intertwined with each other. We got Bon here having to deal with a lot of FGC players here. I don't know if he realizes there's a player being blocked by his iron sights. He could probably see him, or at least his shoulder, if he just put his gun down for a moment. He realizes he's being blocked. He hasn't been shot from anywhere else on the point. That leaves one location for him to shoot at, and he secures the kill. But during all that, Torix has cleared off Charlie. Bond's going to get a little bit of a cap advantage here on Charlie, and if VEA is savvy, they're going to just rain pre-nades down onto Torix's last known location. Here coming the nades. Torix, though, getting the kill onto Ripjaws, and then onto Ivilch. Man, Torix just showing up starting here on the security side with a cap and a few kills to his name. We got Bond trying for some spawn kills, but it's too late. They're all gone out of spawn. Bond, you need to turn around and do some more for your team. He does. He gets a kill on a player just outside of Alpha before getting taken down by Tarpon. And it's all down to Podoroy on a 1v2 here. He's just outside the Alpha position on these sandbags. We got Tarpon here by the low wall, and we got Torix going in for the throat. And Torix just having an insane round, and that is 4 kills and 1 death, 1 objective to his name. That's just insane. We got Joe disconnecting for some reason. We'll see what that's about in a moment, but that's a round for FGC. A very, very, very good round for Torix. We're at a 5-4 scoreline, and still in favor of VEA, but they've just subbed out Galthor for Joe. Joe maybe not having such a great game that time. Maybe Galthor can further aid FGC in a comeback. That was a probably tactical substitution more than anything else. And frankly, it's a decision I agree with. If someone's not having such a great game, maybe getting a little flustered. You know, maybe you just need, again, that sort of change of scenery that another player can bring. It's a good idea to do that. And Joe played extremely well last map. Maybe she'll be back for the third one if we have another one. Right now it's looking like we might, because VA is in the lead here. New player means new routes, which means new potential for pre-nade death. So I'm going to go ahead and watch these pre-nades coming out of VEA. I'm assuming they're still going to be throwing at least a couple. We don't see nearly as many as come out of some players. There's one coming out of security side. Ivilch getting an AK kill onto Galthor. And there goes FGC's sub. And sort of chance for a fresh start. FGC, though, responding with 2 very fast kills, taking down Podoroy and Ivilch. And FGC is getting that Bravo cap done. It looks like they're not even going to try to contest this. Maybe that's a pre-nade coming in. I think that might have been the barrels nade that I was talking about earlier. Ham doing some work back here. Bad Lightbulb refragging Snailman, who Ham just killed. Torix is getting the cap. There's a VEA player up on Terrace. He's going to see him and then get shot from behind. We got Bond here on a ridge in a 1v2. It seems like FGC just spawned back in, but VEA cleaning them up very, very quickly. Bad light. Rubbing out Bond. Tying up the score for his team. We're at 5-5 here. It's again, it's a very back-and-forth match, but the rounds have been pretty one-sided when a team starts to get control. That one, it felt solidly FGC the whole way from the get-go. I think VEA needs to focus a little bit more on killing Torix on Bravo if he goes there again. Torix has been doing very well in the cap department. His last two rounds, he's been getting a cap each time. He is negative in the KD, but he's allowing the rest of his team to go positive by capping them back in, keeping them in the game. Got Ham with a Mosin pick onto Tarpon. I'm sorry I missed that. Let's see if he can do anything else with this rifle before he drops it and decides to go fourth. Looks like he's going to run back for the moment, and I'm wondering if maybe there's a pick on a Snailman. That was a very nice pick out of Ham. I was wondering if there was a scope on the FGC side, and I think Snailman was doing just that. We got Badlight, who's going to push right past Bond. Bond's going to hear him. Maybe fails to react here. Or maybe he's just going to wait for him to come up the Z-stairs. Potter is going to kill Badlight. I think Bond made the call out, and that's just really good communication. Potter picking up a kill due to Bond's call. Galthor's going to take a couple shots at this guy on top Shrine, and again, it's the communication. It's the top Shrine player calling him out, Potter rotating in. Really good response to the calls, and that's going to be another round in favor of VEA. And that was a round one, if anything, by communication. That's just awesome comms, you guys. Slim, it's not cool to call that unless it's actually happening. That's all I'm going to say about that one. Let's see here. Let's see if Ham can get another good pick off the bat with this Mosin from this rock. That was a pick and a half on a Tarpon, getting him just as he crossed behind that wall, shooting at probably his coattails, more or less. He's going to come up to heaven. Unfortunately, whiffs the shot on the Badlight. Badlight with a quick double kill, killing Ivilch and Ham there. Bond knows where he is, though. So Badlight's going to rotate out onto the safer side, catch Bond in the back. Bond is down. Now we're down to Podera and Ripjaws, who are back very far on the insurgent side of the map. And it looks like Ripjaws is going to get picked from Candles. That's Badlight with a 3K this round. Podera going to put an end to that, though. It is just up to Podera, though, in a 1v4, and he's responsible for the sole kill that VEA has gotten this round. I'm lying, of course, because Ham got that pick off the bat. I thought there was only one kill, because once again, Torix has been allowed to cap Bravo. And we are indeed dealing with a sniper here on the FGC side. We got Snailman picking up a, looks like a Elcan, what do you call those things? C79 scope on an M16. So not really a sniper rifle, this is more of the sort of classic BR, you know, DMR role that you don't see played too much in Insurgency. What you do see in Insurgency a lot is players doing what they are doing right now, and that is being very, very patient. This is not often... This is often not a fast-paced game. We've got Podere, who really doesn't have a good decision to make at the moment. He's pretty penned in. And then we've got FGC with nothing to lose or gain by pushing him. So we're just going to have both these teams wind down the clock a little bit and wait for someone to make a mistake. And it's going to be Podere, unfortunately, pushing out the wrong side of Garage, walking straight into Snailman's crosshair. And that's going to be a 6-6 scoreline. These players talking to each other. I hope they know that they can't be heard by everyone else here on the stream. Hopefully they're not saying anything too amusing that we're missing. Hopefully it's just a little bit of friendly back and forth, like, hey, nice shot, good round. I know that a lot of VEA players like to extend the good round. It's just good sportsmanship. Some teams, however, famously silent between rounds, not saying anything, trying to keep up an air of professionalism, and Galthor's not moving. I think maybe they were talking about having a pause. Okay, we got both teams waiting here in spawn. Okay. I'm thinking maybe Galthor has DC'd. Or is timing out. Oh, he's back. Maybe we're good. Not really sure what the pause is about. I do have their voices turned off. We can see what they type. Friendly fire. However, they are choosing to communicate verbally. so we don't quite know what's going on. Looks like Ripjaws isn't moving either. We've got a very, very close game here, though. Let's get some predictions in chat. We're at 6-6, though. Three rounds either way will take it for that team. Who do you guys think is going to come out on top? I see a lot of VEA Take My Energy little Kirby guys in here. I see Joannison, who I'm assuming is probably Joe from FGC, saying FGC is better than VEA. I got Leviathan, who is a moderator, who I don't know, saying FGC, good vibes. I got Foxer saying Tagless is better than losing. And you're right, Tagless is better than a lot of things, like, you know, death, maybe a car crash. It's better than skinning both my knees on a skateboard. I think it comes just on top of clipping a hangnail painfully. Anyways, we're back into this map. Whoever had the connection issue has sorted it out. And let's go back to pre-nade cam here. Let's see what we can get. Because we've got some very aggressive FGC players this time. Let's see if they can get knocked out by a couple pre-nades. They're just going to run straight past them with Badlight making it all the way to Candles. He's just going to lie down in the smoke here. He's gone totally unseen back here. We do have three VEA players up to four FGCs with Torix, once again, just on his barrels position. Someone needs to do something about him being there. Bon and Podoroy playing maybe a little bit too passively, and Ripjaws, I'm not exactly sure what he's doing over here. I think he was waiting for FGC to push, but they're not going to do that until they've got five players up. They have to know that they're going to cap this point. They have to know that they got one off the start, because no one got a pre-nade kill. That was a shot. Podoroy picking up a kill on the bad light, and it's 3v4 once again. Ripjaws is going to meet quite a few players coming towards the Charlie side. You can see Torix, Snailman, and Galthor all looking towards this side of the map. Galthor, I don't know if you can actually see in here. Nope. I am sorry, he's looking exactly at a wall. You know, I think Snailman knows that Ripjaws is here. He does. He's going to tap him out of existence with that M16. It's a good kill on Snailman. And then we got Podoroy and Bon. Just one right on top of the other here in this heaven position. Looks like they're going to make an execute onto Alpha, which is going to cue Tarpin to come in from this outside position to support the player that's already there. That's Galthor just lurking in Alpha. They're taking some shots at Torix, who's over here hanging out by Stilts. He's in the Stilts alley position. It's a nice little cubby to get tucked into. You've got a good view on a lot of places here. Let's see if Bond can maybe get this kill. No, he turns away. He's going to stop going for that one. Podoroy taking a few shots at that box's sandbags position. Not going to come up with anything. They know there's a player near or on Alpha. Bond and Podoroy just trying to work together, try to keep their cool, trying to go for something, a concerted effort, rather than just trying to lone wolf it. Because it's better to have... a wolf pack of two is still better than two lone wolves, you know what I mean? So they've got to work together to bring themselves this round. This really tough position where FGC is just locked down the map. Tarpin taking out Bond makes it all the more difficult. We're just down to Podoroy in a 1v4. I keep zooming out to this map because I just want to show you guys how cupped in Podoroy is. There's not really a move he can make. Even after getting that kill, Tarpin is still there, keeping him on this corner of the map up here. And as he runs out here, he's going to get picked up by the Ridge player. And Torix knows where he is too. Torix can see him. Torix maybe not with the greatest eyesight in the world. There he goes. Picks up the kill, lines him up with the 2K, I must say, delivering that round for FGC. We're at 7-6, and this is looking pretty dire for VEA right now, despite the impressive KDs for their players. It looks like Ham's on track to drop a 20. It looks like Ivilch is even with 10 and 10. We got 10 and 9 on Bomb. We got 11 and 8 on Podoroy. Rip is even. So we don't have anyone going negative on VEA's side. When you look at, however, FGC's side, you've got Galthor dropping a 0. You got Torix with 7 and 11. You don't see anything terribly impressive in the kill department over here, but what you do see is almost twice as many objective caps. So despite getting the kills, VEA's effectiveness is really being diminished by all these caps, and Ham's going to miss a pick. I believe that's Torix, once again, just inside Bravo, but they're trying to pen him through the wall now. If they can get this kill, they will be in a very good way. As I said, of course, Tarpin evening the odds with two kills of his own. We're in a 3v4 favoring FGC. Make that a 3v2 favoring FGC. It's about to be 5v1. It's all down to Bon. He's getting himself a cap, but they've got a very good idea of where he is. Torix is just running right in here. Yeah, they were just converging on his position. They knew he was capping Alpha. It's 8-6 in favor of FGC. This is the best of three on the line. This is the second map. First map being Embassy. If you missed it, it went FGC's way. But not before VEA could take, I believe, you know, 4 or 5 rounds. Wasn't a total wash. This map, however, it looked really good for VEA out in front. The first half was very good. It was solid 6-2 in VEA's favor. And FGC is really coming back. Looks like Tarpon is starting to wake up also. But I'm really just looking at Torix here, who... he's just... they're letting him cap Bravo. They really need to stop this. They need to put a player dedicated to killing the Bravo guy. Because if they can kill a Bravo guy and start from there... Ham getting a pick onto Tarpon. Galthor getting a pick onto Ivilch. If they can kill their Bravo guy and start from there, then they're in a much better position. Badlight is completely surrounded, but maybe they don't know where he is. Bond's going to get a pick kill onto Galthor. And I think Ham is looking for him. I think Badlight's more or less a dead man here, unless they decide to ignore him and run away. Podoroi seems to be aware, though. Here's Ripjaws up on top Shrine. This is Tarpon's favorite position. Let's see how Ripjaws decides to play it. We got Torix here in this nearby stilts position. Ripjaws is just running around. I guess they're kind of trying to catch this guy coming out of candles. They think they know that he's in there. Badlight being very patient. Torix going to get a kill onto Ripjaws. Now, it's one avenue of escape presented to Badlight. He can go out the back here towards Charlie. Ham going to get a kill onto Torix. Unfortunately, Badlight, still lurking, going to kill Ham. But I think Podoroi heard him run. He's going to hear him. And after whiffing the first couple shots, he's going to get that kill. It's a 2v1 Snailman with a scope against Bon in his face. Bon's going to get the better of him. And we're just one round away from this going into overtime. Let's hear it for VEA, guys. Come on, come on. See it in the chat. I'm seeing Slim saying Torix needs better glasses. I think Torix is actually a wonderful person, wonderful player. Sometimes I open my mouth without thinking too much about the impact of the words I have. I did not mean that as a slight at all. But... you guys saw him clear as day. He was in his crosshair. He flicked off of him, and then he had to unscope, start to move, and then flick back in order to secure the kill. That is just not what you want to have happen. Anyways, if VEA can kill Torix on Bravo, they must kill Torix on Bravo at this point. If they can kill Torix on Bravo, I think they can take this to overtime. And there it is. There's what they had to have happen. Ripjaws is going to take out Torix. Ivilch and Ham doing work onto Badlight. We do have Ivilch just running around here. Galthor's going to pick up Bond. Ivilch is going for Snailman. It looks like he knows he's going to be hanging back and sniping. He's going to take him out. He's going to get seen by, I believe that was Galthor taking some shots at him, just reloading inside this alpha position. He's playing far back. We got Tarpon playing just under this terrace position. This is an extremely exciting possible chance for overtime here for VEA. They're in a very good position here. If they were to slip this up, it would just be heartbreaking. I'm not going to discount the possibility of that happening, though, as Tarpon takes out Ivilch. He was just waiting for someone to jump onto that alpha point, waiting for someone to get a little bit overambitious. And here comes Tarpon. He's on this Charlie wall right next to Podoroi. Podoroi hears him. He gets a kill in midair. That was an awesome pick, and it's all down to Galthor. He's running back towards this alpha position for some reason. I'm not exactly sure what he's going to do over here. He's going to die. That's what he's going to do over here. And that makes it 8-8. We're going into overtime. And if you are not familiar with overtime here in the DGL, we play the best of 6. We do 3-round halves. So after 3 rounds, you're going to switch sides. We're going to reload the map. And what's going to happen here is you're going to start on the side that you started station on. So for VEA, that's going to be security side. This is the side that they won 6-2. So if that's any indication of how... overtime should go. They should pull out an early lead and hopefully keep it. You know, and again, I'm giving away some of my bias here. But I would really like to see a game 3. I'd really like to see VEA take this into overtime. Let's get some overtime hype going in the chat, please. And, so you've tried to win 4 rounds out of 6. If you tie 3-3, we go into a second overtime. Same rules. 3-round halves. Best of 6. And if you are lucky enough to tie twice in a row, I believe at that point, per DGL rules, the match is officially declared a tie at 8-8. If you win in overtime, the match will be recorded as 9-8. That's an easy way to read scores if you have been looking at the DGL website or at match results from the DGL. Looks like we got Bad Light running over here towards this kind of weird abandoned parking lot over here. It's a nice little gas and go. What do we got here? We got Jerowin. Jerowin? Whatever. Never really explored over there. I do know that... I don't know how much time we got before this match starts, but I do know if you go far enough out that way, there's like a little mini-map that's, I guess, part of the... And I mean mini, like not like mini-map displaying points. I mean miniature buildings, miniature everything. A little miniature map that I think is part of how they build the skyboxes in Source games. I'm not exactly sure. I'm not a game designer, but it's funny. If you have a minute, just you know, come over here in noclip and just keep going that way until you start to see terrain and there's just some weird shit out there. Fun fact. I think we're waiting on Galthor, or maybe Joe's coming back in. Here comes Joe, she's coming back in. We're just waiting on the fifth FGC player here to start overtime. And let's just, you know, let's hear some overtime hype if we could, please. We have a lot of VEA take my energy. Once again, it looks like it's been constant here, which is really awesome. And just to answer anyone's questions, my name is Torso. I play for this team called Boat. And we're streaming here on the twitch.tv/thedgl, and we are live here in the first round of overtime. I'm going to see if we can get any pre-nades caught on tape here, see if we get any kind of exploderizing of the security side here. And they're not going to wait out the pre-nades. They're not really going to wait them up. If they were to throw some, yeah, Tarpon's going to pick one up on Ripjaws. If you see people rushing like that, it really starts to make sense. Tarpon getting a kill. On to Bon. 5v3 right now. Ivil's trying to get this Bravo cap, and this is what... Yeah, that's what VEA needed to do throughout regulation time. That was a nasty game from Snailman. Gonna take out Ivil. Podero is gonna go down to Joe, and Snailman's gonna get a team kill. He's gonna refrag Podero. For VEA, Ham's going to miss a couple picks across onto the shrine position. They know where he is. That player on Ridge, I can't believe he did not take the shot. He's going to get shot from behind, though. That was Bad Light Bulb coming out of hell. And you may notice that my scoreboard still says 8-8. I'm going to keep on counting up the rounds this way. The magic number at the moment is 12. If we hit 11-11, that means another overtime. I'm just going for overall rounds played here. I'm not going to reset to 0-0. Just so we don't think it's another match. This is overtime of the second match of this best of three. If FGC wins this, they win the best of three. Did Joe suicide? TK. Yes. Joe trying to save face for her teammate, saying that she killed herself. And let's see what kind of pre-nades we got coming out. We got one coming over here by this Charlie side. That could be deadly to Bon. Bon's just going to barely make it out with his life. That was a lot of fire coming in. And in the meantime, Ivilch getting an MP5 crosspick onto Bad Light. Tarpon's coming up here to this very deadly shrine position. Ivilch getting another kill onto Joe. We're in the exact opposite position we found ourselves at the beginning of the last round. We got five players up for VEA. And now, okay, we got four against two happening now. As soon as I make the count, of course, it changes. 4v1. And it's all Snailman. We got Podoroy already half-capped here on Bravo. Snailman's coming up in parkour rock position with the Savvy. Gonna check that ridge position, take out Ripjaws. He's gonna get picked up by Bon. The flick onto Bon. Oh my god, he's made it a 1v1. And now Ham and Bon gonna take down Snailman. Looks like Bon maybe legged him through or just by that pole sitting there. That pole can soak up a lot of damage. I don't even know if you can pen it. Snailman surviving the shot from Bon, almost clutching that round in a 1v... I think it was a 1v4, which was just insane. But VEA is going to come out on top. It's 9-9. That's 1-1 in overtime. We're tied up once again, and VEA really needs this next round. We're only going to play three rounds here, this being the third, on this side, and then we're going to switch. So VEA needs to pick up this round. They need to not die to pre-nades. They need to not get cross-picked by Snailman. They need this round. They need to come out on top, security side. That's their stronger side. If they start out strong, then maybe they have a chance of taking this overtime. Bond starting it out with an M4 kill onto Tarpon. He almost gets another one onto Joe. Onto Bad Light, but he's going to kill him. Ivil's taking out a couple players himself. I believe he killed Joe earlier, and then he killed Torix. There goes Ivilch to Bad Light. Bad Light with just the nasty, nasty reaction time this round. You've seen him kill two players seemingly while running. I believe he's just hip-firing as soon as they became visible to him. Got an aid coming out towards Bravo. They're trying to kill the player if he was on the barrel's position. Snailman going to shoot him through the window. There goes down Poteroy on Bravo. Ripjaws putting the round back into VEA's favor, and it's just down to Snailman in a 1v2 against Ham and Ripjaws. Snailman looking to clutch, but little does he know, Ham's capping Bravo. He's not even going to check it. It's a 1v5. Snailman is very close to dying here. I think Ham saw the barrel of his gun. He's going to wall him through that little cinder brick wall and deliver the half in favor of VEA. VEA is up 2-1 in this overtime. They have to win two more rounds. We're about to switch sides. And if they win two rounds on Insurgent side, we'll be going to the third map. The third map is Ministry. So far we played Embassy already. We're on Station currently. Loading. And yeah, I would really look forward to a third map between these two teams. They're very, very evenly matched, as we're seeing here now. We see overtime, I don't want to say we see it often. You maybe play one match that goes to overtime in a regulation season. So seeing it here is great. We had overtime last night as well. This is a very good thing. It means that we're starting to see teams get on more of an even ground with each other. We're starting to see fiercer competition. We're starting to see more just, you know, tight, exciting rounds here in the DGL. Of course, as I'm talking up the DGL, we see something very unprofessional coming out. That was a double restart. That was two players Archoning to restart the map at the same time. So we're back. It's still 2-1 in favor of VEA in this first overtime. Torso was just getting hyped. Fucking ESP. I think he just knows how I like to cast things and how I like to talk things up. No one's watching the stream, and if they are, we have a 120 second. That's 2 minutes of delay time. It will not do you any good. In fact, sometimes it will work against you, especially if I'm talking constantly throughout it. Because my God, the grating sound of your voice in your ears when you're trying to concentrate would just be horrible. We got pre-nades coming out for security side, and only one coming out for insurgent. We got Ivilch opening up with an AKS 74U kill onto Joe here inside Alpha, I believe. And Ivilch is just going to keep pushing his advantage here. He's going to push up all the way to these hell doors. There is, however, Ripjaw's going to kill onto Bad Light. Torix, I was about to say, is on Bravo. He's getting that cap. They stop him. Ripjaw's taking down Torix. Poteroy killing Tarpon. It's down to Snailman. Once again, Snailman's the last up, it seems, for the third time in a row for his team. Bond playing it patiently, knowing where he's going to come from because he heard his teammate die. Going to close out that round. And we're at 3-1 in favor of VEA here in overtime. They have one more round to go to clinch this overtime and bring us into a third map. It's going to be Ministry. And that's about as even a map as you can have. It was neither of these teams' picks. It was the map that was left over after the map ban. And, Ham thinks I was Archoning. I am not Archoning. I'm going to prove it by saying Archon say I'm not in Archon. There. Proven, I'm not in Archon. Got a couple grenades again coming out from security side. Let's see if that does anything. It's not. It's really hard to get those grenades off from the security side. I'm following Snailman because I want to see if he tries for any cross picks, and it doesn't look like he's going to get anything done. Bad Light's going to pick up the kill onto Ripjaws. Meanwhile, we've got Ivilch taking out Bad Light, Tarpon taking out Ivilch, Bon taking out Joe, and it looks like we just have the frag train rolling, the refrag train. Players getting killed, making the call out as to where they died from, and we do have, looks like VEA starting to cup in FGC. They're completely surrounded here on this Bravo point. Bon can see his legs. He's going for the spray. He's missing the spray, but he calls him out, and it's Tarpon against Bon and Poteroy here. He's the last player up. He's in the clutch. He almost has this point cap for his team. They need to stop this cap. They need to stop this cap right now. Unfortunately, they don't, and there's five players up. Make that four players up for FGC, and just now Bon's getting his cap started on Alpha. I wonder if he's going to go down to this pre-nade that's going to come in. This is going to be a very nasty pre-nade. Has the game sense to turn around and check his ass because he was getting flanked by Bad Light. Bad Light's going to get the best of him. Nonetheless, Poteroy goes down on Docks, and that was so very, very close to overtime going in favor of VEA. That was unbelievable. It was just extremely lucky, extremely good play from FGC, a good combination of luck and skill there, getting that Bravo cap as far along as they were able to do it. So all that Tarpon had to do was sneak on there for another couple seconds. We got a pause coming out of Torix. I'm not really sure why. This could be a tactical pause. I do see his ping going up, however, to 205. So it's tactical in the sense that it's really hard to play the game when you're looking at players about a fifth of a second after they have gone around a corner. Or do I have a decimal error? Is that a 50th of a second? Someone in chat, tell me if 200 milliseconds is a fifth of a second or 1/50th. Someone who's good at math, maybe one of the Euros. I'm really bad with the metric system. And again, we just have the VEA take my energy train here. Foxtrot, yes, the DGL has gone corporate. I'm getting paid to do this. B Jelly. Making the big bucks here at the VEA. Of course, we're playing for our $10,000 tournament prize pool. And you had to know about that to register for it, to be eligible for it. And seeing as I was the only person besides Poteroy to do so, it's really up in the air as to whether or not we decide to spend on a VEA or a boat. Big thanks to Ura Gaming for sponsoring, not only giving us some free server use, but also that $10,000 I was just mentioning there. They're so very generous. Of course, server hosting is an extremely lucrative business, and that's why they are sponsoring little to unknown FPS gameplay. No, seriously, we love them. These servers are great. We're extremely thankful for them providing us a place to play and have this much goddamn fun. Ivil's deciding to change his name to Up-Down, Down-Up. Not exactly sure what that is. Someone fill me in. Someone tell me if that's offensive so I can... Oh. Vape-vation. Okay. Could have been a lot worse. What is this mystery symbol here? The N is always backwards. Hokidok.
Changing bags.
Got bad light bulb. Getting the kill onto the tin toothpaste that was there only moments before. Okay, guys, we are tied here in the... no, we're not tied. Excuse me. If we're 3-2 in favor of VEA / VN. Here in overtime. If VEA takes this round, we'll go on to a third map. They will win this match. If FGC ties it up, we'll go into OT2, which will be another best of six. Let's say first 2-4, three round halves. I'm getting a little bit flashed there. I'm so glad that doesn't flash me anymore. Late prenades doing work. That's two prenade kills from Ham and Ripjaws onto Tarpon and Joe. Badlight going to get a kill as well. So already we're in a 3-4. Torix getting a kill onto Ivilch. That was just a very slow reaction to Ivilch, who maybe should not be vaping while he's playing. Can even the score up here onto the players. 3-3. We got Ripjaws here just waiting for this player to come out of hell. He's not being patient enough because as soon as he looks away, yep, Torix is going to start peeking. Snailman's going to get a kill onto Poteroy, and we're down to a 2v3 with Ham kind of stuck here in the middle between Torix and Badlight. If he's not careful, he's going to get pinched. However, he does have an opportunity to get a kill onto Snailman, who's been called out. Bad Light Bulb going to kill Ripjaws. It's all down to Ham, who's going to go down to Torix. Now we're going to go into overtime number two, I think.
Gotta reload.
Okay, we're going to play a second overtime. I am only going to get hoarser as we go on.
Give me a sec, loading.
This is honestly one of the closest matches I have seen in a minute between these two squads. So, you know, I'm leaving the score here at 11-11 because that is the overall round count that has been played. It looks like they're just going to switch sides here with FGC moving back. Or, no, sorry, we need to switch sides. We need to change teams because we're starting another overtime, so VA needs to start on... I'm completely turned around because there's been so many restarts and overtimes. We're going to go live on restart. We are on the correct size that we need to be. VEA starting on security. You're going to have to excuse my confusion. I really, really wish that we had some kind of config or program or custom server thing that would make it a little bit easier, do away with some of the Archon commands, maybe automate some of these switches and decisions of who wins overtimes, how overtimes work, etc., switching sides. Tarpon says he's dead. As we can see here, he is alive and well. Need to restart the map. He died. I'm going to wait for them to do that. I'm not going to do anything in Archon except for talk, just to avoid things like double restarts, for which I was blamed earlier. However, all of you faithful DGL stream viewers know that I did no such thing. I'm completely exonerated. My, this is an ugly window texture. Will not be installing that in my house in the Hamptons. Alright, this is the beginning of Overtime 2. FGC probably going to throw a few pre-nades here. Let's see if it catches anybody out. Maybe they have... Mr. Archon, please kill everybody. No, I will not do that. I refuse. Let's see if pre-nades have any bearing on what happens here in this round. We got Ripjaw just proning back there behind the sniper house. Are we live? We must be live. There go the pre-nades. They duck, dodge, dive, and weave, and they do not hit anybody. Ham waiting here patiently in this hell position. He's got Torix and Jorix very, very near him, watching him through the wall. Joe, that's not okay. No, she's just trying to watch the doorway to her right and to her left simultaneously, because players could come from either way as I am talking. Ivilch gets a kill into Tarpon and Snailman with the quick refrag onto Ivilch. Here comes Joe, running straight into Ham's crosshair. Torix, though, getting on the point, doing what he does best. Getting that cap started on Alpha, he's got bad light here for backup, and here comes Ham. The rotation needs to come out of VEA right now. They will only get up... Okay, now they're going to get up three players if they get this cap. It's like Ham lining up his teammate before flicking over to Torix. It's all down to Snailman in a 1v5 in this first round of OT number 2. If you want Snailman to clutch, type 1 in chat. If you want Snailman to fail, type 2 in chat. If you are impartial, like you should be, cheering for anyone who's doing well all the time, type 0 in chat. I'll be typing a 0 in chat. Alright, we got Ripjaws taking down Snailman, delivering the first round in VEA's favor of OT number 2. Just checking scores from that round, it looks like the only player to pick up a kill was Snailman there on the FGC side. I'm wondering if maybe FGC is getting a little bit worn down after these long, long rounds. I'm wondering how long I've been casting for. I've been going for almost an hour and 40 minutes. So if I'm getting tired and I'm not even playing, you can kind of imagine how these players are starting to feel. So here we go into the second round of overtime number 2. So far in this game, we've played far too many rounds. You can just add up the scoreboard there on top of your screen. I can't see it because it's an overlay. We got Bond taking out Bad Light behind the forklift position. Torix dropping down from the hell position, or from the heaven position, seeing if he can maybe catch the player moving past, but Bond is already somewhere where he can't kill him. Snailman getting a double kill with a grenade onto Poteroy and Ham. That is absolutely devastating, and immediately puts FGC with a man advantage here in the second round of overtime. Ripjaw is evening it out with a kill onto Joe. He's going to continue on to Charlie, where Tarpon is waiting on this top shrine position. He should know that Tarpon is up here. Tarpon's been playing here the whole time, and Tarpon can just barely see his head through the latticework on Terrace, and he's going to call it out as a kill, I'm pretty sure. Snailman getting a kill onto Ivilch. If he doesn't recheck this Charlie side position where Ripjaw is still alive, Tarpon could go down. I think Ripjaw has maybe just whiffed a couple shots on the Tarpon. Yes, I think he did. Tarpon knows he's here. He just can barely see the top of his head. Tarpon has very, very, very good eyesight and very quick reflexes, and Ripjaw is frankly lucky to make it out of there with his life. The top of your head is all you need to see to kill someone in this game. Torix does not get flashed by Bond, who instead decides to slide in. Torix is going to get the easy kill, and he is going to get the cap too. Possibly, not even possibly. He is definitely going to get that cap, bringing his team back in. That prompts Ripjaws to step onto Charlie. It's really the only move he has, but Tarpon knows where he is. Tarpon's going prone, unable to kill each other here. Eventually standing up as Ripjaws starts to slide to the right. That's going to be a round in FGC's favor, and that was the 24th round we've played on this map. This is absolute insanity, back and forth. These teams are so evenly matched. I would not be surprised if this overtime ends in a time or ends in a tie as well. We are into the third round here of overtime. Number two, and the only three players in this overtime so far without kills would be Bad Light, Joe, and Poderoy. They're playing their positions. You know, they're doing everything they need to do. It's just they haven't gotten lucky yet. We've only played two rounds, so. Not saying that this is going to have very much bearing on what happens for the rest of this overtime. Everyone else, kills have been pretty spread out. Grenade's not doing anything, and let's actually see what Ripjaws is going to do here on this Charlie side. I'm very curious to see how he's going to play this side, just because Tarvin's been locking it down so much. In the meantime, we got Bond and Ham picking up a couple kills onto players on the left side, the alpha side here of the map. Bond flanking through, but unfortunately he's going to push right into Snailman, who's waiting for just such a kind of thing to occur. Getting a little bit impatient, though, stepping away. This gives the advantage to Bond if he sticks this out. Snailman re-peeking. I think both these players have an idea that the other is there, and we're just kind of waiting for one of them to make a bad move. It's going to be Snailman trying to take some shots. He's reloading. Tarpon's going to get a kill on Ripjaws. And Bond's just going to wait here. Snailman with a good peek, though, showing just his head, kills Bond. And we're down to Ham versus Joe. Ham versus Tarpon. Tarpon being patient, working on that cap, waits for Ham to push him. It's another round for FGC. We're going to switch sides. Last OT, we had exactly the opposite round score. We had two rounds in favor of VEA on their what seems to be their favorite side, this security side. Got a pause coming out after the switch. Not really sure what that's for. It's going to be ping again. He's up to 300. This could be an explanation for the low KD. Could be the explanation for the reason they're playing him on objectives all the time. I'm not sure where Ham is going. Maybe he thought it was live. Already did, but it didn't work. So we got six kills here. Got 10 players, and one boob. We got six kills here on Snailman. Two for Tarpon, one for Torix, Badlight, and Joe. So Snailman doing a little bit of carry here. We got five on the other side here for Ham. Three for Bond, two for Rip, one for Iv, and thus far, zero for Poderoy, hoping he can show up for his team, because in this OT, FGC have won two of the four rounds they need, and VEA has only won one. So we need VEA to win the next three rounds without dropping anything to win this OT to keep it from going to a tie. If FGC wins one round, if they get 3-1, or 3-2, or if any point between now and the end of this overtime, if they win one round, they'll be playing for a tie, or the FGC win. Excuse me, my voice is starting to croak just a little bit. We're up past the 1:45 mark, so I'm just really starting to lose it here. Ugh. Type 1 if you want to hear Torso talk less and just view more. Type 2 if you want Torso to continue shredding his vocal cords, his poor, poor vocal cords. We are live here into the fourth round of overtime. VEA not throwing too many pre-nades so far this map, so I'm not going to expect to see too many come out of them. What I will look for, however, that I was missing earlier is the cross-pick, and of course, as I say that, I'm missing nades. Ripjaws, in fact, getting a kill onto Tarpon. That's a big one. Tarpon showing up huge for his team the previous two maps. Poderoy getting a frag onto Joe. That was a late frag, and I hope Ham hears this player that's sitting right next to him in the smoke, which we still can't see. In Cubby right there, you can see his two players just next to each other. Poderoy picking up another kill, And we're down to Torix and Snailman. They know where Torix is, so that means Ham's going to get the really easy headshot kill onto him. That was a great angle to view that communication kill from. Now it's just down to Snailman. Snailman, again, in a clutch situation. It's a 1v3, which is a little more doable than a 1v4, and a lot more doable than 1v5. But not if you slide into your opponent, Snailman. That's going to even up our overtime score at 2-2. That was the 26th round we've played here on Station today. If I never see Station again, it will be too soon. Oh, my God. And Torix is subbing out, I believe, because of his ping. I think that means Galthor is coming in. And VEA would be nice to let them do this, because, correct me if I'm wrong, you're only allowed to sub one player per game? Are you allowed to sub more when you start overtime? You guys already subbed twice, didn't you? Ham is pulling the rules, which Torix knows, because I think Torix helped write them, being a DGL admin. Someone look up the DGL rules really quick, see if this is something that they can do. It's the same sub, but you're subbing out different people. True, no problem. Once per half for... the gentlemanly thing to do... Bad Light pointing out that there's been 9 halves. Oh, God. The gentlemanly thing to do would be to let the guy with the unplayable ping, it was up there 200, 300, sub out for someone who can at least play the match. And they're going to let him do that. They're not going to call him a technicality. We're here 2-2, tied, going to the 5th round of the second overtime. We've played 26 rounds so far, and it's really, honestly, starting to wear on me. Let's try to get that hype train started again, guys. If you want to see this map end, let's hear everyone cheering for really anyone. At this point, anyone to win these next 2 rounds would be wonderful. We got Ham starting out with a kill onto Snailman, Bad Light responding with a kill onto Ivilch, and that nade was really nasty. I think that might have been from Potoroy. It almost comes over the ridge and kills Tarpon dead. Ripjaw is picking up a kill on the Bad Light, and it's a 4v3 in favor of VEA. They would be wise to slow things down right now, and definitely not TK each other. I saw Potoroy line that guy up. They know someone's capping on barrels. They need to stop this Bravo cap. This is what's plaguing them through regulation time. The Bravo cap is getting up to 90%, and it's going to go through. So Cam's going to be able to get this refrag, though, onto Joe. It's not really a refrag, because I guess you don't refrag caps, but you know what I mean. He gets the kill, and then Snailman taking him out through the Bravo house. That was nasty. We got a 2-on-4. Bon and Ripjaws up for DEA. Make that a 2-on-3. Bon with that really gross position there on those stairs, just prone. He's going to get this cap unless they jump on right the second. They're going to be just a moment too late. He's actually going to leg that player. And I think that was Snailman. He's going to finish the deed there onto Snailman. And it's a 2v5 now. VEA bring this round back. A bit of a nade coming out there from Galthor. Let's see if it gets any work done. It does not. Galthor and Tarpon really near this Bravo position. Galthor's going to run into hell and die to Ivilch. Tarpon picking up what's probably a consolation kill at this point on Potoroy. He is in a 1v4, previously a 1v5 clutch. To make that a 1v3, he gets a flank off, but he is definitely called out now. Ivilch knows exactly where he is. Tarpon hurt Ivilch, though, and this peak could go poorly for Ivilch. He's in a 1v2 now. He's taking this from a 1v5 single-handedly to a 1v2, and Bond and Ham just need to stop. They need to figure out where he's going to go. They need to not move. They need to not give him any information. That includes sound. Ham needs to stop moving. Ham, stop moving. He's watching the right place. He jumps. Luckily, that was not enough information for Tarpon to snap to him and get the kill. Ham jumping on top of those barrels might have even been a good play. He's going to secure the kill with the quick snap. And with that, FGC is playing for a tie if they can win this next round. And if VEA takes this, then they will win this map, finally. Let's see some even more VEA hype here in the chat. Ham's going ham with 10 kills in 5 rounds. That is great. It's a great scoreline. He's only died three times, too. It's really awesome. Snailman answering a little bit with his own 8-4 scoreline, and Tarpon not far behind with 7-5. We got some really good play coming out from all these players. And we see Joe pistol rushing. Is she going to stop here on Bravo? She is. Ham with a frag and then an M1 pick. And then Ivilch. We're down to a 5v2 already, and they just need to find this player on Bravo. They need to know that someone is on Bravo. It's half-capped already. Ivilch is going to get on Alpha and then quickly get flashed by, I believe, his teammate. Ripjaws is looking for this Alpha player. He's going to get it. And that, my friends, is a double overtime win for VEA. We're going to go into map number 3, and hopefully we'll be able to have at least a 5-minute break or something so I can just stand up and run around and not be sitting down for this whole fucking 2.5 hour ordeal. I sound like I'm having a horrible time. I'm having a wonderful time. I hope you all are all too. We are just at the 1 hour 50 minute mark. This is looking to be very easily the longest streaming experience I have ever had, and I've been talking through the entire thing. So if you could show some support for the teams and maybe a little bit of support for your completely out of breath and completely hoarse caster, you know, I would heart you forever. We're going to take this bomb. Three of us have to leave. We have three of us that have to go. Looks like we may not be getting into this ministry map. Bad Light is saying they forfeit. I don't think they're going to make them forfeit, especially after how epic that match was. We're going to see this play out down in the bottom left-hand corner of your screen. We already pushed this game back a week for you guys. We see a little bit of diplomacy coming out from Bon. We've got a little bit of talking going on that we are unfortunately missing, but we can kind of imagine what's being said here. There might be a player on the FGC trying to leverage this into a win situation for FGC. If you can't play the match at your scheduled time, then you sometimes are forced to forfeit if your opponents are not gentlemanly enough to push it back. Does Bad Light speak for everyone? So we got a little bit of an interesting situation happening here that really the captains should be talking about. They should not leave this to the other players on the team. This is why we have captains. These are points of contact. Ham has a final tomorrow, and he's not about to put his academic career in jeopardy for a video game, which is a good life call for him. that's pretty good. Foxtra's asking, Torso, are you a DGL.org admin? No, I am not. I am just someone that they trusted with the stream key for this channel. I don't know why they did that. I am possibly the world's least qualified caster. Poetry has work at 5 a.m. tomorrow, and he is in the French side of Canada, so I think that's like the East Coast-ish, so he's... man. I don't know what time it is for him now, but it's pretty late. He's been playing for about 2 hours now. This is an insane endurance test for these players. And I'm sure they're just all talking it out right now. I'm just going to stay here live with you guys and watch the action here as Poteroy disappears into the sunset. It looks like they may be playing this match tomorrow, and I should really be checking... my messages to see if anyone is telling, saying something like, Torso, shut the stream off, we're not going to play. Because I don't think they're going to play, but I'm going to stick this out until the end. I'm actually going to ask, in all caps, so tomorrow? Let's, see if anyone is nice enough to respond here. Get you guys the full story here at the DGL.org. We're currently tied 1-1 after a full two matches of overtime in that last match in this best of three between VEA and FGC. This has just been insanely close, insanely hard fought games. Mr. Kalau, Spanish Torso, Spanish. I do not speak Spanish. I speak a very, very small amount of French. I speak a very, very small amount of Japanese. I've taken probably the worst language classes one could possibly take living in the States when I was back in school. At this point, I really am just waiting for someone to say, are you playing tomorrow? Looks like everyone's leaving. I'm just waiting for someone, anyone, please answer me, for fuck's sake. wants to be able to tell all these people here watching this stream, of whom there are 22. So. Well, no one is going to tell me, but judging from the fact that no one is here in the game anymore, I'm going to leave you guys after a marathon set of games, almost just 5 minutes short here of 2 hours straight of casting and bullshitting and talking my ass off. Thank you all for sticking with me through this. This was a real test for everyone involved. Insanely hard-fought games for both these teams. Really good play here at the DGL, .org. My name is Torso, and I will be signing off now. Thank you all so much. We'll let you know when this map, third map, will be played via the Insurgency Reddit, so keep yourself posted over there. Good night.